Welcome to the e-workshop series on post-lockdown healthcare facility and systems preparedness and response for COVID-19, which is organized by Global Development Center, GDC, and Research and Information System, RIS, in collaboration with Public Health Foundation of India, PHFI. If you have any questions regarding the topic of today's webinar, you can put it up in the Q&A section. There's a Q&A section down below where you can put up all of your questions. There'll be a Q&A round after the session. And if you have any issues regarding the audio and video of the webinar, you can put it up in the chat box, the normal chat box. Our ID support is there to help you with that. Thank you. Now I would like to hand it over to Dr. Sandeep Bhalla, who is the Director of Training, Public Health Foundation of India. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Very good afternoon, good morning, good evening to all the senior healthcare professionals, those who have joined today from 17 different countries all over the globe. This is in continuation of our e-workshop series, which we started in collaboration with Global Development Center and Research Information System. This is the fourth series today. The COVID-19 pandemic has created unprecedented disruption for the global health and the development for community. The short-term complications of this global challenge are evident everywhere, but the long-term consequences of the pandemic, how it will reshape the health and the development institutions, occupations are still difficult to imagine. If you see, as per the today's WHO data, there are around more than 6.53 million confirmed cases all across the globe, with more than 3,87,000 mortality. If you see the African region itself, they are having around more than 1,01,000 confirmed cases, and Southeast accounts for 3,22,000 cases with 8,942 confirmed fatalities, with maximum cases arising in India. In continuation to our series of e-workshops for healthcare professionals, we are happy to announce and to launch the fourth series in collaboration with GDC and RIS. Public Health Foundation of India has started this series in collaboration with these two eminent bodies. Public Health Foundation of India is a premier public health tank set up in the 2006 with the initial kitty given by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. This is the body which is acting as a catalyst in the field of public health. And we have eminent bodies in collaborations with us. We have Research Information System, which is a research system, which is a think tank based in the New Delhi-based Autonomous Policy Research Institute that specializes in issues and related to the international economic development, trade, investment, and technology. They have Global Development Center established under RIS that aims to institutionalize the knowledge on India's development initiatives and promote their replication as a part of knowledge sharing in Asia and Africa, with the help of its institutional partners, including civil society organizations. Bringing the life back to normal after the lockdown remains a major challenge and concern in coming weeks. Looking at the urgent need of this pandemic and preparing the opening of the workplaces, especially industries and healthcare facilities, there is an urgent need for preparing the healthcare professionals on safe and effective use of scarce resources and protecting the health team while serving the community indeed. So we have constituted today the four webinar series covering the various topics, and we are very happy to have the leadership available with us representing the Research Information System and Global Development Center also today. We have Ambassador Amar Sinha. Ambassador Amar Sinha is currently the chairman of Interim Advisory Council for Global Development Center at RIS. He has retired from Indian Foreign Services as Secretary Economic Relations in the Ministry of External Affairs, New Delhi. He joined the RIS as a Distinguished Fellow in November 2017 as has lent support to several think tanks focused on Afghanistan and other strategic issues. Sir has had various different assignments previous joining to the RIS also. He also advises Chambers of Commerce on trade and investment issues. It is only because of his push that PHFI is in a position to conduct four series in a regular way. And we are very thankful to RIS and GDC leadership for helping us and giving us these opportunities for giving these webinar series for our international participants. I would request Ambassador Amar Sinha to give his valuable remarks and open the sessions today. So over to you, sir. Sir, you are muted, sir. Kindly unmute. Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
You can't hear.
Yes, sir. Please go ahead. We can
sir,
hear you.
Please go ahead, sir. Please go ahead. Sir, your opening remarks are there, sir. We are looking forward.
Can you hear me, Dr. Balla?
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Oh, good. I could hear myself.
Sir, we are requesting you to give the opening remarks on behalf of GDC and RAS, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Balla, Dr. Reddy, and greetings to all the participants to this fourth webinar organized by PHFI and GDC. In fact, over the next 4 days, you will be learning about the protocols for COVID-19 screening, preparing of healthcare facilities, importantly, resumption of hospital services. That is absolutely important because under this lockdown and when the pandemic was spreading, I think most non-COVID health services were more or less under suspension. At least it was in India. I don't know what was that was the case in the countries that you represent. And of course, the gender implication. We have added this because as it is any situation of distress, whether it's pandemic, war, it imposes a disproportionate pain or responsibilities on the mothers and the sisters of the family. So it is very important both in terms of how we look at their physical health, but also the psychological aspects, which as professional healthcare people, you may be able to better guide them. Of course, government policies will have to also look at how they compensate them economically, because many of them would have lost. And because of the lockdown, in fact, many of them have lost the ability to even earn whatever little they used to earn before outside. But anyway, I'll leave that to the experts. Let me just tell you that on behalf of the Global Development Center, which works very closely with RIS and DFID, which we have set up, it is basically an initiative to universalize the best practices from around the world. It focuses on sharing experiences between developing countries, which basically helps furthering the SDG goals, because all of us are grappling with different difficulties in the socioeconomic sector. And of course, this COVID is an added imposition, let me put it this way. So we are very, very thankful to PHFI, Public Health Foundation of India, for having joined hands with us. In fact, it was their great idea and initiative, which we have adopted. We should give the credit to PHFI to have thought of this very innovative way of reaching out to our partners in Asia, in Africa. Already over 500 people have benefited. And I hope that the professionals who are joining today will take home good lessons and also share their experiences so that we can learn as we grapple with COVID pandemic in India. With these words, I wish you all success and a very successful and enriching next 4 days in understanding each other's problems and trying to find common solutions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable inputs and giving us this opportunity to PHFI. We have the leadership available from Public Health Foundation of India also. Today, we have Professor K. Srinath Reddy, who is the President of Public Health Foundation of India. Sir was earlier the head of the Department of Cardiology at All India Institute of Medical Sciences. And if you see that under his leadership, PHFI has established 5 Indian Institutes of Public Health in different regions of India. He's a Padam Bhushan awardee and also appointed as the first Bernard Law Visiting Professor of Cardiovascular Health at the Harvard School of Public Health, and presently serves as Adjunct Professor of Epidemiology at Harvard. He holds various advisory positions in several national and international bodies and recently published a book, Make Health in India Reaching a Billion Plus. He's also the adjunct professor at Rowland School of Public Health, Emory University, and first Indian to be elected on National Academy of Medicine, and was awarded several prestigious international and national decorates or fellowships. Professor Reddy is a member of Government of India Technical Committee Task Force for COVID-19. Advisor for Government of Odisha, Andhra Pradesh and Punjab on Public Health. He's a member executive group of International Steering Committee of WHO COVID-19 Solidarity Trial. We're really thankful to you, sir, that you have joined today's session and you're giving us the opening remarks on behalf of Public Health Foundation of India. Over to you, sir. Sir, muted, sir. You are muted, sir. Kindly unmute, sir. Kindly unmute, sir. Yes. Over to you, sir. Please, sir.
I'm unmuted. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you, sir. Yeah.
Okay, right. Thank you very much, Dr. Bhalla, and thanks also to Ambassador Sinha. It has been a great partnership so far with RIS and GDC, not only to ensure that PHFI can reach out to a number of doctors in, but also across the world, reaffirming that this major global pandemic requires a great deal of knowledge sharing and also exchange of experiences to build the best possible response to control it, whether in the public health arena in the community or in the healthcare arena in the hospitals. Addressing the challenge of how best to provide care in the hospital settings, which is the theme of this particular workshop, it is very important for us to recognize that hospitals are under great pressure in many countries because of the increasing load of COVID-19 cases. Of course, who to admit and who to keep at home, these are decisions that are being revisited frequently based on new knowledge. But even then, the pressure on hospitals grows as the number of cases grow, even if the pressure is felt in some locations only in a country. Particularly in India, we are seeing that some of the large cities are under great pressure, even though much of the other parts of the country are not experiencing the same level of severity. However, as hospitals come under pressure, we need to refine our protocols and working systems in order to ensure that we can quickly screen, diagnose, and manage through appropriate protocols. Some of the systems that we have been used to in the past will have to be revisited and revised in order to improve our level of response in a public health emergency. Of course, we need to ensure that we can maximize efficiency while minimizing the risk to the healthcare providers. Indeed, healthcare providers who are battling in the hospitals are certainly facing several challenges, whether it is in terms of adequate personal protection equipment or the high caseload of sick cases who may need intensive care, and particularly having to deal with anxious families who cannot even visit their relatives. There are many such challenges, including also the fact that many of the non-COVID-19 cases are not able to get attention in the hospitals. And what do you do with emergency surgeries? What do you do with obstetric care? What do you do with cancer chemotherapy? Those are other issues that come up. But at least in the case of COVID-19, now there is a great opportunity for us to exchange knowledge and prepare our response systems to the best of our resources wherever we are in the world, and raise the level of our competent and compassionate care to a level that most of the patients will benefit. And in this, it is important for us to exchange international experience and learn from each other. These webinars provide that kind of an opportunity, and PHFI is very happy to be part of this effort, where we are reaching out to 17 countries through this particular round of webinars. And we hope that all of you will find this an enriching learning experience. And I'm sure whether it is as a participant or whether as a faculty member, each one of us will have a great deal to learn and benefit from. But I do hope that all of these will actually be translated into much more effective hospital-based response and improvement of hospital systems that will actually endure beyond COVID-19 and improve our health system performance, even otherwise, in terms of the quality of services that we can provide. Wish you the very best and a great learning exercise over the next 4 days. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your blessings and your valuable inputs. Today, what we did is that in each session, in the coming 4 sessions, we have invited eminent personalities from the different countries. Today, we have eminent personality from Sri Lanka, Dr. Tilak Silva. Dr. Tilak Silva is the president of International Primary Respiratory Group representing Sri Lanka. And he has been the major mover for bringing the message advocacy of these webinars into Sri Lanka. And a lot of colleagues from Sri Lanka has joined. So we have requested Dr. Tilak Silva to give his views, whatever the feedbacks they have received and how these webinars are really effective for the Sri Lankan participants and what is their views on that. So over to Dr. Silva. Dr. Tilak.
Dr. Tilak, you can unmute yourself.
Sir, you can unmute. Unmute, sir. You can unmute yourself.
Can you hear me? Sir.
Yeah, you are.
Okay. Right, okay. Thank you very much, Sandeep, for giving me the opportunity from the behalf of the BHFI to express my views and share a bit of experience of the Sri Lankan context of this COVID-19. So this, first of all, let me give you a special thanks to, as a foreign doctor, Primary Care Respiratory Group President, the sessions of webinars that you organized was really timely arranged. And the topics were very relevant to all the sectors of the healthcare, not only primary, even secondary and tertiary, as well as the medical administration. So I think that was well designed. Program. At the same time, I should say the resource personals that you have selected was extremely good. You know, they are very dedicated and they have up-to-date knowledge about the subject matter, what they were delivering. And to the audience, and it was amazingly they delivered it. Even my colleagues in Sri Lanka, whom I shared the link, told me that it was a super program and we really updated the knowledge as well as the latest development about the COVID pandemic in the world. So thank you very much. So having said that, I just want to share a bit of Sri Lankan experience about the COVID disaster, or rather pandemic, that unprecedented pandemic affecting the whole world. You know, Sri Lanka is an island nation surrounded by the sea. You know, it's not a border with any other country where only the foreign personnel or individuals coming by aircrafts. So we have 21 million of population with diverse ethnic and religious communities. Actually, our first case was detected on end of February. It was a case from China tourist. We treated successfully in our hospital, in a government hospital. So then after that, slowly we were getting few cases, basically the imported ones as a tourist nation from Europe and other source of cases. Then we decided to shut down the country on mid-March. So after that, for continuously 69 days, we actually shut down the country with giving only the essential services to operate. So during the shutdown, it was quite effective. And with the being very limited facilities in a developing country in Sri Lanka, the strict measures were taken to identify, then isolate and treat the cases, positive cases, exclusively on the government hospital settings. So no private hospitals were allowed to take any of the COVIDs. All were done in the government hospital, a few designated hospital, dedicated with community physicians as well as epidemiologists and so forth. So if all the treatments were given free of charge with utmost care. So at the same time, we mobilized other public health bodies, epidemiological experts, especially the military. The military, the Army, Navy, the Air Force, we had a lot of resources because we had a huge successful infrastructure of military, because we had, as you know, Sri Lanka had 30 years of unrest war. So we have a very good, we defeated the terrorist organization. So we have a very good infrastructure of military. So they were bought, we were mobilized successfully into the management, and it was well effective. I said they, because they were going on to the ground level, identifying and managing then and there, and this, that really manages to keep this problem on the bay. And we developed a few clusters in the community late to come. So we, what the government did was, with the military help and the police, we cordoned that areas and we locked down it, and so that we could sustain that cluster of a certain community in the only that local area, few meters perhaps, close the roads, and we manage them then and there. So if you take the statistics up to now today, we have 1,800 positive cases so far. Out of that, we have only one deaths. So I think statistically, if we consider, I think Sri Lanka is in a green zone in the worldwide context. So I think we should thank for all the stakeholders of doing the hard job in the front line. The Sri Lanka has this quarantine policy also quite strict. At the moment, all foreign arrivals has to be quarantined 14 days in the government-sponsored facilities. As I told you, the military and all, they have big facilities all over, and they really look after well with the basic food in the bed, and according to the international guidelines, the quarantine. And at the same time, right now, all the arrivals from foreign countries has to the PCR testing in the airport. So in the airport, is everybody has to do, or 70 hours before leaving the particular country. So I think that's quite effective in managing and keeping this pandemic on the bay. So our primary care physicians, as I'm also one, we have started our practices recently with a strict guideline given by the health authorities and the professional bodies locally and internationally. At this point, I should thank again PHFI for the advice and the things, what are the guidelines I given, was very useful for me personally, as well as I shared with our national bodies. Thank you very much, PHFI, for that, giving that guideline. It was very effective and very practical. So, in the summary at last, I should say the most important thing is the social distancing, as we all experienced all over the world. Aggressive and proactive screening, isolation of the positive cases with strict quarantine will give a very good results in this pandemic, perhaps until maybe we can find a very effective treatment and vaccine in future, or months or days or whatever to come in forward. So my sincere thanks to Public Health Foundation of India for giving this opportunity and express our experience in this regard. Thank you very much, PHFI. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable inputs and experience of Sri Lanka for managing this pandemic situation at Sri Lanka, and how these webinars are really helping your colleagues also. Now we are coming to the series we are going to start today. We are going to have a first session of the series that is on protocols for screening and for screening management, screening diagnosis and management of COVID-19 cases. And for the same, we have very eminent faculty, Dr. Varun Arora, Associate Professor in Department of Community Medicine at Pandit B.D. Sharma Postgraduate Institute of Medical Sciences, Rohtak, Haryana. He has vast field experience in public health. His work revolves around various areas, and he has been involved. He has worked in license with Government of Haryana since 2012, and serving as a resource person for the workshops across state. Currently, he is looking after the preparedness and management of coronavirus as an officer in charge control room COVID-19 at PGIMS Rohtak. So, over to Dr. Varun Arora. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bhalla. At the outset, I'll first thank you, Dr. Tilak Silva, sir. You have made my presentation very easy by showing us what to do and a good example, classical example. I also thank the other eminent panelists. And without much delay, Vishnu, can I just do my screen sharing? I'm not able to do.
Yeah, please, you can do.
Okay. So it's showing host disabled? Yeah.
No, you can. You can, sir, now.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
So I once again thank PHFI. I also thank RIS and GDC for having faith in me and giving me this opportunity. So today we are going to discuss about protocols for COVID-19, screening, diagnosis, and management, including management of suspects and confirmed cases. So,
Sir, you can go for the louder, presentation view, sir. You can go for a presentation view and a bit louder, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, bit louder. So,
am I audible? Right?
It's fine, sir. It's fine. Please go ahead.
I'll just show you. I think this is better, Dr. Bhalla.
This is much better, sir. Much better.
Yeah, thank you so much. So today we are going to discuss, once again, I repeat, that screening, diagnosis, and management. And as Dr. Silva has said, that Sri Lanka has shown a way that there is no drug, and the only drug we have is social distancing, quarantine policies, isolation of the positives, and these are the drugs which have given us the evidence. When there are so many new pharmaceutical agents which are coming into the picture every day, there is some hope, then there are some clinical trials, there has been a lot of infodemics, but still we are not able to find one solution to this COVID-19 problem. So first of all, let's begin with our world scenario. And as already Dr. Bhalla has reiterated, that we are having around 6.5 million cases. And if you see the graph, you see like where the lockdown was not practiced in the beginning and air travel was allowed, you can see the condition of America. Then you can see the Europe, they have seen their peak and slowly it is slowly rising, and the number is also getting on the high side. Now, two peculiar situations I would discuss. Southeast Asia and Africa, because most of the audience are from these two regions, there is going to be a peak in the next few months to come. If you see, by March 31, when there was already so many cases in America and Europe and East Mediterranean, we were having no cases. So that gave us a lot of time to prepare ourselves. But despite our preparations, somewhere this COVID-19 is able to just break the guards and has now established a community transmission in most of the communities. And you can say, Dr. Silva said Sri Lanka has shown us a path. So I would like to emphasize here two, three things. You will have to do a SWOT analysis of your resources and also various countries, porous or non-porous borders. So if we are saying that you have a porous border like India, like we have something like Nigeria or Ghana, which has a boundary and all the countries across it, the chances of transmission is going to be a little bit higher. You cannot control it. Even the WHO in its latest statement has said that air travel now, should we start it or not? It depends on the countries, but it will also restrict the supply of the essentials, especially the vaccines, the logistics, the drugs, the human manpower. So that is why every country will have a different scenario. Currently, we can just say that Southeast Asia and Africa, there is going to be a rise, and in Africa, you can see that there has been a sudden rise in the last 2-3 days. So before going to the screening part, management part, most of the audience is basically also belongs to public health specialty. Every district, every state, and every country need to establish one COVID-19 care pathway. Why it is essential? We have observed that sometimes the screening and also the triaging and the assessment, they are actually into the different areas. And the COVID-19 patient are able to infect other people while going from one place to other place. So what should be the scenario? Like when you have already done the quarantine, you have already done the isolation, still we are talking about a situation when community transmission has already been started. First of all, screen for COVID-19, okay? So you need to find a place, and then when you do the screening and the person is coming positive, then you have to develop a triage system. and like already done in war, red, orange, and green, and you send that person according to the situation, the severity of the symptoms. You do the clinical assessment and then you go for the treatment part. China also gave us one of the very good example when they created new hospitals. In India also, now the problem that we are facing is that the line between COVID and non-COVID is a very thin line, and when it is crossed, I'll cite the quote the example of my own institutions. Right now we are having around 200 plus COVID patients, and we have treated around 150, and we have seen around 20 cases which are actually positive in the non-COVID areas. And when we did the tracing, it was very difficult to understand that why so many cases in the non-COVID areas are coming. So based on that, whenever if you are a health administrator, you are a public health manager, you have to develop one COVID-19 care pathway for the state level, country level, and at the district level. And if you're diagnosing a person with a mild or low risk moderate disease, so what to do in that? Try to develop COVID care centers, public health care centers, isolation centers, you can name it anything, but those should be isolated and should not be the having the same sharing area with the non-COVID areas. China did it. China developed big hospitals, and it was appreciated also. Many of the countries, like also Dr. Silva said that, yes, in Sri Lanka, they also did the isolation and a strict isolation. First of all, when it was said that most of the cases were basically thermal screening was done, which was actually not advisable. Only thermal screening cannot restrain the people. So if there is going to be the air travel, quarantine for 14 days is the minimum that you have to follow. So when we are talking about the same thing, quarantine and the mild or low risk cases, they need to be basically shifted where into the COVID care health centers. So based on that, I will just begin with my presentation. These identifications. First of all, there has been so many tests, but till now WHO and many countries have said that the gold standard is RT-PCR with a sensitivity and specificity in 90s, and a person with laboratory confirmation of COVID-19 infection, irrespective of clinical signs and symptoms. The reason being, 80% of the positive confirmed cases are basically either asymptomatic or low, having very mild symptoms like flu or no symptoms at all. So RT-PCR is the gold standard. There are definition of suspected, there are definition of probable, but we are going now today going to discuss about laboratory confirmed cases. There has been some antigen detecting rapid diagnostic test and some antibody detecting rapid diagnostic test which are blood based, but WHO does not currently recommend both antigen detecting rapid diagnostic test for patient care and also not antibody detecting rapid diagnostic test. However, the WHO has advised for their usefulness in disease surveillance and epidemiological research. In Indian context, like there are few states which are having a very high number of positive cases. So what is the problem statement we are facing? What is the level we are achieving? So disease surveillance and epidemiological research, we can use them, but they have a very, I would say, moderate kind of sensitivity and specificity. So based on that, in India, we are following this protocol in which it says that if you have an influenza-like illness, you go for a rapid blood test. If it is positive, then you just do the clinical assessment, home treatment, home isolation, and if it is negative, and you still think the person can be positive, you do the RT-PCR. So again, the RT-PCR is gold standard. Currently, antibody tests are discouraged for diagnosis of any positive, any COVID-19 patient. So we are talking about the disease. So the disease is either asymptomatic or mild disease, moderate disease, and severe disease. When we are talking about asymptomatic, more than 40% cases does not show any symptoms. When we do the contact tracing, we are actually finding these are basically the high-risk contacts who have come in contact with a COVID-positive patient, but they have not developed any kind, any symptoms. Now, this is a very unique scenario. This is one of those diseases which is highly infectious, but the case fatality rate is still ranging between 3 to 6%. So this high infectivity, sometimes it is very easy to say that it is very less fatal, why we should be worried. But this infectivity, this R naught we are talking about, is so much, I would say, problemsome for us that even case fatality is low. But when we are talking about a large number of population, the number would be equivalent to any disease which is less less infectious but more fatal, like bird flu. So the in that bird flu, the case fatality was very high, but the case infectivity rate was low. But in this scenario, infectivity is very high, case fatality is low. But if you are having a person who is elderly, the person with some comorbid condition like diabetes, hypertension, or you are having a coronary artery disease, any immunocompromised state, cancers, in that scenario, still that 3 to 6% is going to be a very high number, because if you are talking about the population 60 years, the case fatality rate ranges between 14 to 25%, depending on various areas, but 14 to 15% is the average across the countries, international. So based on that, first of all, the first thing you need to do is do the triage into that area, and after the assessment, categorize the person into these categories. First is asymptomatic. You can keep them in COVID care centers, isolation wards. And then if it is a mild disease, these are the symptomatic patients. Now, what are the most common symptoms we are talking about? It is the dry cough. It is the fever with myalgia. So these are the two very common symptoms. Slowly we are watching other symptoms also. Like we can say the sputum production is there. Diarrhea is also one of the symptoms. So there are many other symptoms which are there, but most common is still fever, myalgia, running nose after that. So based on that, you divide them, and then the moderate disease. If any adolescent and adults with clinical sign of pneumonia, so this is a lower respiratory tract infection, fever, cough, dyspnea, fast breathing, with no signs of severe pneumonia, including SpO2 more than 90% on blue air. Now, these have been taken from the WHO guidelines. Every country has a different scenario, different protocol. So in India, we are talking about that it is SpO2 more than 95%, then we say it is moderate. And if it is less than 90%, we call it severe. So I am going by the WHO criteria because these are well accepted across the nations. So if we are talking about a child with clinical signs of non-severe pneumonia, cough or difficulty breathing already been discussed, or chest withdrawing, especially in the children, and no signs of severe pneumonia. In children, we say the fast breathing. Accordingly, we say, like we have done in other MNCI, less than 2 months, more than 60, 2 to 11 months, more than 50, and 1 to 5 years, more than 40. And when we are talking about adults, it is more than 30. When we say, yes, it is that it is a moderate disease. And there are now various investigations. The diagnosis can be made on clinical grounds. So if there is any low and middle income countries and you don't have various facilities, radio imaging and others, still you can diagnose, categorize the patient based on the clinical assessment, just on the SpO2 by pulse oximetry, on the respiration rate also. If we are talking about the chest imaging, radiographs, CT scan and ultrasound, they may assist in diagnosis and identify or exclude pulmonary complication. Now talking about the severe disease or severe pneumonia. Now what are these? So basically adolescents or adults with clinical sign of pneumonia already been discussed, with a respiratory rate more than 30 breaths per minute, severe respiratory distress, SpO2 less than 90% of room air, then it is a severe pneumonia and you will have to take these patients seriously. And a child with clinical sign of pneumonia with at least one of following: central cyanosis or SpO2 less than 90, severe respiratory distress like fast breathing, grunting, chest withdrawing, or general digital sign like inability to breastfeed or drink, lethargy or convulsions also. So the person can be like bluish also. So, and the diagnosis already again to suffice it is the chest imaging. And this is the stage which is one of the last stage when we say acute respiratory distress syndrome, onset within 1 week of known clinical insult like pneumonia and new and worsening respiratory symptoms, chest imaging, diagnosed by same radiograph, CT scan and lung ultrasound. I will not go much into the CT scan and its details into this because this is a broad spectrum and we are talking about the management. So we will just discuss the brief outline. Bilateral opacity is not fully explained by volume overload, lobar or lung collapse or nodules. These are the findings of chest imaging. Origin of pulmonary infiltrate like respiratory failures, not fully explained by cardiac failure or fluid overload. It needs objective assessment like echocardiography to exclude other scenarios. And oxygenation impairment in adults, mild ARDS. These are the basic, every country and their ministry has developed their own guidelines. So I will not go much into this PaO2 and other guidelines. I will discuss how to take care of such cases. After ARDS, there are also sepsis and other scenarios which we can discuss later. But what to do? So I'll just go, make you go through few of the WHO scenarios. So like this is a WHO guidelines about the clinical management. So the point is, there is no thumb rule which would say that this is the path you have to follow. What we are doing, like it is a storm and all countries are having their ships and everybody is looking after the other that how they have crossed this storm. We all are in the same storm. Everybody is experimenting with the new drugs. Everybody is experimenting with new innovations, out of the box thinking. Till now, again, I would say the major answer to this would have been the strict implementation of quarantine, isolation, health, this cough and hand hygiene. So basically these were the currently proven scenarios. Still we should follow it even if it is a community transmission and use of mask. And also WHO has given the guidelines like N95 mask is used more than it should be. There is acute shortage of supply. So based on that, it has been simplified. So rather than complicating the things, I will try to go it in a very lucid manner. So what WHO suggests? The patient who is a symptomatic, needs a mild patient with symptomatic treatment, he be present to where? In an emergency unit, in a primary care unit, OPD department, and even you can see them in community outreach activities like home visit or by telemedicine. So what to do in that scenario? First of all, as already we stand, you have to basically, and this is both for suspected and confirmed, because there is a very thin line between the suspected and confirmed cases. When we are talking about suspected and confirmed and RT-PCR, RT-PCR has also its limitations. We are taking sample in three. It is either bronchoalveolar lavage when it is a patient on ICU on oxygen or in a morbid condition. But if it is a mild patient or asymptomatic patient, you will go by the nasopharynx and oropharynx. Now, RT-PCR has a sensitivity and specificity of 90% plus, but 95% in some scenarios. But the probability of shredding of virus in nasopharynx and oropharynx, it varies. And various studies have shown that a positive case when we are taking nasopharynx, the probability of shredding of virus is 70% to 75% alone. In oropharynx, it is around 33%. Even if you club them both, it is around 85 to 90%. Still, there will be 10% cases who are positive, but due to less shredding of virus, we can miss those cases. So it has been proven if it is a severe disease, even if it is the person, if the person is COVID-19, you have to manage all cases of SARI, severe acute respiratory infection, as COVID positive. But what to do in mild cases or suspected cases? So what WHO says, it suggests that patient with suspect or confirmed mild COVID-19 be isolated to contain various transmission according to the established COVID-19 care pathway. I will share the COVID-19 care pathway of India. So based on that, you can develop or you can follow the COVID-19 pathway depending on the prevalence of cases, incidence of COVID-19 cases in your respective countries. Why it is very important? Like a country like Ghana, Nigeria, or Myanmar, there is limited resources. the health expenditure on public health is less. So these are the cases. Sometimes the really needy people don't get the beds, they don't get the ventilators. So it is time to do a very good triaging, because 80% of people don't even need oxygens, and they should be either separated in an isolation unit, any hotels or any other place, any sports ground, with a minimal number of staff nurses and doctors, so that they can be managed very well. Okay, so what to do in that scenario? In African and Asian countries and India,
it is sorry to interrupt you, sir. I'm sorry to interrupt you. I guess your PPT is visible, just the PPT. I guess you're on some other screen. Your PPT is visible, sir. You are on some other screen, I guess.
Sorry.
I was saying, sir, you are on the, we can see the PPT. You are on some other screen, I guess. You have shared the particular PPT window only, so.
Okay.
You can just share your screen only. Okay. Not the particular window, sir.
Right. So I think it is visible now?
Yes.
This is perfect, yeah.
So I was sharing the WHO guidelines. So it clearly suggests that if it is a mild case, management of mild case, so in that scenario, we give every country should develop a designated COVID-19 health facility, community facility, or home isolation. When the number is rising, self-isolation will save a lot of resources that should be available for the moderate or our severe disease. So in area with other endemic infection that cause fever, such as malaria, dengue, or febrile, patient should be tested and treated for those endemic infections with routine protocols. Now we are talking about protocols. Every country has different protocols. And even the person who is having COVID-19 can also have malaria and dengue also. There has been studies which says the person is coming with some other disease, tested for COVID-19, and he is positive. So there is going to be a situation where you will have to see if it is a rainy season. You will have to see whether you are only testing for COVID or you have to also test for malaria and other diseases. So the decision to monitor a suspected case with mild COVID-19 in a health facility, community facility, or home should be made on a case-to-case basis based on the local COVID-19 care pathway. Additionally, these decisions may depend on the clinical presentation, requirement for supportive care, potential risk factors for severe disease, and condition at home, including the presence of vulnerable persons in the household. Now, I'll share the scenario of India. Here, home isolation is advisable by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare based on very strict criteria. If you have a single room where nobody else can come, you have a caretaker at home, you don't have any elderly or any susceptible person who is at very high risk. So based on that, many of the states are now advocating, like New Delhi is also advocating home isolation because the number of beds are very less. So you should think according to the scenario, number of patient load, number of hospital beds, and the trend analysis. The person can be taken care at home or they should be taken in the hospitals. Okay. So if managed at home isolation, WHO has given guidance for home care for patients. So what is WHO recommends? WHO recommends patient with mild COVID-19 be given symptomatic treatment such as antipyretic for fever and pain, adequate nutrition, and appropriate rehydration. In our experiences, our logical empiricism says nutrition is a very, very important factor which we are not stressing. Nutrition builds up the immunity. There is going to be an immunity developed by our own body within 7 days, IgM, then IgG. So what is the basic need we require? A good protein diet, a healthy diet, also good fluid intake. This is actually somehow does not get that much importance when we are talking about the drugs. We are so much drug dependent that these basic yoga, nutrition, rehydration, and also pranayams, breathing exercises, these also have a very good remedial effect. There are not much clinical trials on to this, but yes, based on the previous experiences, these should be followed and these should be advocated religiously. Okay. So there has been some question, which antipyretic to be used? Sometimes they say, like, ibuprofen, should we use it or not? There is diclofenac, should we use it or not? Paracetamol is very safe, but again, it should be at the states that can be used. There are seven adverse reactions with all the other drugs, but NSAIDs can be used, especially the crucin for the fever, this paracetamol. So, and the other thing is counseling. So basically, this is about our normal patients, which can be taken care in any COVID care centers. What WHO does not recommend and which is followed at many places. WHO does not recommend recommend antibiotic therapy or prophylaxis for patients with mild COVID-19. Till now, WHO, I'll repeat again the word, till now, WHO has not advocated any pre-prophylaxis or post-exposure prophylaxis. I'm repeating my word, WHO has not recommended pre-exposure prophylaxis or post-exposure prophylaxis in the dearth of clinical evidences. In India, there is guidelines for healthcare workers that you should use hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis, one dose weekly, up to seven. First, it was for 7 weeks, and now it has been extended. I would like to quote here, Dr. Bhalla, I've been just labeled as high risk 4 days back. My team developed, one of the person was diagnosed as COVID positive. So I'm at home quarantined right now. So we are following these protocols, which we are advocating to others.
Good.
So widespread use of antibiotics should be discouraged, because many people think that if that is pneumonia, there is going to be a chances of bacterial infections. Yes, there have been studies which says 8% to 20% are the risk of bacterial infections. But in mild cases, it should be discouraged, as their use may lead for high bacterial resistance. Okay. So coming to the second part, which was the management of moderate COVID-19 pneumonia treatment. Okay. So basically, what is the recommendation into this? Again, if you are having very resource-crunched healthcare setup, then even the moderate illness may not require emergency intervention or hospitalization. But it again varies from country to country. In India, moderate cases are advised to be hospitalized. So every country, based on their resources, are following and just taking idea from these guidelines and preparing their own guidelines and changing them as the evidences are arising. Okay. So as per WHO, they can be hospitalized, they can be taken care at home, but isolation is must. So decision of location, again, on the case-to-case basis. And in areas with other endemic infections like fever and malaria and dengue, febrile patients should be tested and treated for those endemic infections per routine protocols, irrespective of the presence of respiratory sign and symptoms, co-infection with COVID-19 may occur. So somehow COVID-19, already been discussed by Ambassador Sir, that COVID-19 has taken a lot of resources which could have been utilized for NCDs, for mother and child care, and other infectious diseases. So if the person is coming to you with fever and cough, that does not mean that the person is COVID-19. So don't forget to test them for other infectious diseases also, because they are also going to rise. So many times in COVID-19 is so much in our head that rest of the test we are forgetting. Okay. So again, what is the use of antibiotics? WHO recommend that patient with suspected or confirmed moderate antibiotics should not be prescribed unless there is a clinical suspicion of a bacterial infections. Okay. So what is the scenario? COVID-19 cases can experience a secondary bacterial infection. A recent systemic review in the hospitalized patient report, only 8% were reported as bacterial or fungal co-infections. And in older people with long treatment clinical facilities or children less than 5 years of age, to provide empirical antibiotic treatment for possible pneumonia, as these patients are not hospitalized, treatment with excess and antibiotics. So if you are having elderly at home isolation, you can give them a shot of antibiotics because they cannot come to the hospitals and they are very prone for hospital acquired pneumonia also. So if you are admitting a patient who's mild or moderate, can be managed, try to avoid such patients in the hospitals, because there is going to be a risk of hospital acquired pneumonia all the times. Okay. So you have to do those people who are at home, you have to have a telephonic communication, telemedicine also. So there should be community outreach teams also. For hospitalized patients, there are various warning signals, various scores also, and you have to monitor the vitals. I have already discussed what is mild, moderate, severe COVID-19 cases. Now we are talking about the management. Now, severe pneumonia management. Before that, let me come to the point. How many cases do you think is going to be having severe pneumonia out of 100? Out of 100, 80% would be having mild or asymptomatic disease. 10 to 15% would be needing just like a moderate disease, or less than that, a moderate disease requiring some oxygen. And less than 5% would be required for severe pneumonia, or would be developing severe pneumonia. And those will be those which are already having any comorbid conditions or any other like age and other factor, immunocompromised state. So what is happening right now, and there has been some criticism also, that a lot of stress is given on the ventilators, but that much stress is not given on the public health policies implementations. So even severe pneumonia patients are there. You need to develop project as a public health specialist. For example, you're having a population of around 10 million. So just in chat, you can tell me how many cases do you think, I'm again repeating, a district or a country with a 10 million cases, a 10 million population. So how many oxygen beds and how many ventilators would you require? And even if you require them, would you be requiring them all at one time? Or you will be developing those disease in progression, some will be coming out. So I'll be happy if you are with me on this platform and you just share with me on a population of 10 million, how many oxygen beds and how many these ventilators you would be requiring. Okay, so just building on that, severe pneumonia treatment. All areas where severe patients may be cared for should be equipped with pulse oximeters, functioning oxygen systems and disposables, single-use oxygen delivery interface, nasal cannula, ventilatory mask, and mask for reservoir bag. I forgot one thing to share. Like a country who are well developed, like Europe and America, USA, they say that even for every patient, there should be single stethoscope, there should be single dedicated equipments, investigating tools for those people. It is not possible in country like India and others. So here we have to pool our resources. So we should be very much having a logical framework of thinking, preparing. I think this will be discussed in the tomorrow session, hospital preparedness, that how much you need to prepare. Okay. So these are the marks. And what is the recommendation? Immediate administration of supplemental oxygen therapy to any patient with emergency signs and to any patient without emergency sign if SpO2 is less than 90%. Okay. So again, adults with emergency signs like obstructive or absent breathing, severe respiratory distress, central cyanosis, shock, coma, convulsion should receive emergency airway management and oxygen therapy. During resuscitation, the target is SpO2 around 95%. It should be more than 94%. Okay. So once the patient is stable, target more than 90% in SpO2 in non-pregnant and 90 to 95% in pregnant women. Now, a study has shown that the pregnant women are at not that much risk. The severity oxygen demand in normal population is around 13% to 15%. But in pregnant women, a study done in China suggested that only 6 to 8% women needed are this severe disease, developed severe disease. So God has protected pregnant women. But you have to be very careful while managing the pregnant ladies. I will address the pregnant woman case management here only. There has been no evidences like in HIV that the pregnant woman should be promoted for cesarean. Cesarean should be based on other conditions like child distress or other complicated scenario of mother, like a twin pregnancy or other placenta previa. So in that scenario, not based on this COVID-19 infection. COVID-19 infection is not advocated as one of the indication for caesarean. The second is breastfeeding. It should be advocated because it is a risk-benefit ratio. A fast criteria like we do in HIV, affordable, feasible, accessible, sustainable, and safe criteria. If you cannot do it, promote breastfeeding. Yes, there are chances of spillover, but our children are very much immune. The case fertility is very, very less. So based on that, pregnant women, sometimes it is being suggested that go for caesarean section, then fumigate the normal delivery. And if a lady has in third trimester positive, try to delay the progression of labor so that by the time she delivers, she can become COVID negative also. So this is another scenario. If somebody has developed COVID-19 and has been tested at 36 weeks, try to delay the progression of labor up to 39 or 40 weeks. So what will this will do? This will give us a chance in which the person can be, the pregnant lady can be COVID negative. So the treatment can be, the management can be done as a COVID-19 negative pregnant woman. Okay. Now talking about the oxygen level delivery, nasal cannula, it is around 5 liter per minute. Okay. Venturi mask, 6 to 10 liter per minute. Face mask with reservoir bag with flow of 10 to 15 liters. So there has been I'm going by the simple lucid way. There has been a lot of, I would say, technical inputs into this. Various guidelines of anesthesiology, various guidelines of medicines have given a detailed discussion. But since we are having less time, I would like to spend more time in the question answers and your queries. So children with emergency, so in that nasal cannula is promoted. Okay. So these are the basically scenarios that you should, and again, like if there is having a secretion productions, so in that scenario, you can do the breathing techniques with gravity assisted drainage. So these are the normal guidelines which are also being followed in normal severe pneumonia cases. Okay. So this, I think I have discussed about the management part a little bit. We can discuss this more in the question answers part. So coming back to the presentation. So we discussed the ARDS and various management part. Now giving you one of the example, what is the algorithm that India is following? Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So any person who is a suspected or confirmed case, okay? So they are reporting directly to COVID dedicated facility. Then he is again triaged or screened for mild or very mild disease, moderate disease and severe disease. In India, moderate disease is when SpO2 is 90 to 94%. The respiration rate is 15 to 30 minutes. And severe disease is when the respiration is more than 30 and SpO2 is less than 90% at room temperature. Okay, I can zoom it also if it is not visible. Yeah. So we categorize them, and based on that, we have labeled COVID care centers. It can be a hotel, it can be a lodge, it can be a hostel, it can be a stadium, depending on the numbers you are having. Okay, so try to don't use your primary health centers and community health centers. Keep them reserved for your other infectious diseases and non-communicable diseases. So some of the countries are actually shifting their primary health centers into COVID centers. So if you are developing them, then where the other people will go? Other infectious diseases, infected people, where they will go? So in that scenarios, try to think out of the box. Try to develop new hospitals or convert the new buildings into these COVID care centers. So if it is a moderate case, then what you do, then we are developing a level of kind of a first level hospitals dedicated COVID health care centers. Okay. So COVID health centers. So first was COVID care center. It is not any hospital, then COVID health centers. It can be a hospital, it can be a block level hospital, and then we are having the third situation, a severe disease. So we have labeled it as dedicated COVID hospital with ICU facilities. So here all the people need oxygen. So in that scenario, you need to have oxygen availability at COVID health centers also, and particularly at COVID hospitals with ICU facilities. So we are testing everybody for COVID-19, and if it is coming positive and their situation is deteriorating, then we shift it to from COVID care center to COVID health centers, from COVID health centers to COVID hospital with ICU facilities. So these are just the names. The point is, you can develop a three-tier system, you can develop a two-tier system, that these are for mild moderate cases, this is for severe cases, this can be for mild, this can be for moderate, this can be for severe, a hierarchy. And based on your trends, you can analyze how much number of beds you need for the mild cases, how much for the moderate cases, and how many for the severe cases. Okay. So when we are talking about management, every country is following their different protocols. So in India, we have our AIIMS, which is an apex institution. So first of all, I'll just share this flowchart. Then we will zoom in. So if you can see, this is basically a treatment. I will just go by the few of the points. Assess respiration rate, assess oxygen saturation, assess any constitutional symptoms like confusion, drowsiness, or anything. Assess their blood pressure, and based on that, admit them into various facilities with oxygen or ventilator facilities. If the person is admitted in your hospital, if it is, then give oxygen supplementation, antipyretics, antitussive antibiotics. Also, in India, there is, has been question mark whether to go with hydroxychloroquine or not. So these are kind of an algorithm which every country can follow for their own or place. Ministry of Health and of various places can develop such kind of treatment protocol. Okay, so it is followed in AIIMS. Various other hospitals, private hospitals, are following their different protocols. Okay. Now coming to the various, one of the crucial part which will be having a lot of debate and questions. Okay. Antivirals, immunomodulators, and other adjunct therapy for COVID-19. Okay. Now we begin with chlorine and hydroxychloroquine. Then we started with azithromycin. Then we thought ivermectin. Then we thought of remdesivir. Then we thought of lopinavir. Then we thought of tocilizumab. And there are others, interferon beta 1 alpha and plasma therapy. So many studies, so many research, but the evidence is not very much high. Many of these pharmaceutical agents are actually under trials. Phase 3 trials are phase 3. Trials are going on to this. What is WHO take on this? WHO recommend that the following drugs not to be administered as treatment or prophylaxis for COVID-19 outside of the context of clinical trial, that they can should be only used for clinical trial. Now, various countries have various guidelines. Few of Southeast Asian countries have advised for hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis for healthcare workers involved in patient care of COVID-19, high risk contacts of COVID-19, 3 weeks for high risk contacts, 7 weeks and above for healthcare workers. And the guidelines are basically, again, I would say this is infodemics or information, everyday information is coming. US has I would say their CDC guidelines and FDA. FDA has advised about the use of remdesivir. It has not approved. I am again repeating the word. FDA has not approved remdesivir, but what on emergency protocol. They have advocated of use of remdesivir in clinically sick patients who are in the needs of oxygen or they are in the moderate or severe pneumonia, ventilators. So they have advocated remdesivir, but not in the case of mild cases. So lopinavir, the same applies for lopinavir. So many of the antivirals, WHO has given the statement, but also few of the countries have started a few of the drugs. Plasma therapy, it is also being followed in few of the institutions in India. Tocilizumab is also being practiced in many of the places in India also, especially in the private sectors, because it is one of a very costly pharmaceutical drugs. So what your country is following, I would be happy to know about it in the chat box, because the evidences are actually confusing. one study which was basically given by which was published in Lancet, and also WHO made it a standpoint, which was having a registry based meta analysis, which said that use of chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine is basically led to lot of mortality, and this trial was stopped. The second trial, there was in British journal, this BMJ, which advocated hydroxychloroquine. So every day a new trial coming, new evidences are coming, and based on that basically new guidelines are coming. But I think there is one word which I'll again repeat here: logical imperialism. We all are treating and looking after the cases around us. What is the scenario at your place? Is hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine helping a bit? So sometimes we should not wait, because the results of clinical trial will come after 2-3 months. So these antivirals, immunomodulators, and other therapy, like the first evidence that came from France, they say that hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin led to a lot of reduction into the severity of the disease. So every day new things are coming. I would say you use your own local evidences. This is kind of a shared risk communication. So you can also go for some local clinical trials also. You can see the evidences. But right now WHO say this is information in development. Plasma therapy has shown very good results in many of the private hospitals in India. Hydroxychloroquine has already been advocated in India. And now we are thinking about tocilizumab. So it depends on country to country. One thing which again I would like to emphasize here in the end, that you should take care of your hospital staff. You can bring ventilators, you can bring the drugs, but you cannot develop hospital staff in a day or in a month. So potential staff shortfalls can occur for recent non-attendance due to stress, overwork, mental health concern, and prospective sickness. So in the context of COVID-19, healthcare workers may have concerns for their own health. So you need to address them. More than drugs, concentrate on your hospital staff. Because if they will get infected, if they will be having a lot of mental health issues, we cannot be in a situation where you can tackle an epidemic. So sufficient rest, recuperation, as well as that need to be accounted. So in such circulation, give them sufficient rest. Make a pool, team A, team B, team C. So ensure safety and protection of health, healthcare workers. I discussed in one of the webinar, people are obsessed with N95. N95 were not at all developed for healthcare workers. It was actually a pollution mask. An N95 mask was that if any size of less than 3.3 micrometer cannot cross this, and virus size is 0.12 micron, the respiratory droplet, which is around 0.5 micron, and nuclei also, which is around 0.3 micron, which cannot pass it through. But sometimes N95 mask is not available, then you can use 3 or 4 layer surgical mask also. You should not be worried about that. And also there are N95, P95, R95. You should discuss these are easily available. FFP1, FFP2 are easily available. So based on your availability of resources, so, but they should not be misused and they should not be abused. They should be adequately used. So high risk exposure in hospital staff is a very dangerous situation. So you need to assess your health hospital staff for risk assessment. The time is short, so I'll not discuss much into this. You should do the high risk and the low risk assessment. And if it is high risk, advise those people to restrict from work for 14 days. And if it develops fever, test for COVID again. And if it is not, then return for work. If it is a low risk exposure, then self-monitoring for 14 days and they can come to work if it is basically your need of the hour. So we discussed in a very lucid manner, what is the scenario? What are the various categorization of the disease? What are the various treatment modalities and the advocacy of the WHO? We have discussed about the various drugs and the evidences available about hospital staff. So I think this webinar would have been a little bit, we tried to make it lucid, that in the end, everybody is not aware of the COVID-19. Hospital staff is scared of working in the COVID-19 areas. You need to develop a positive environment, You need to lead by example. You need to develop that conviction that, yes, we are the corona warriors and we can come out of it. I am right now a high-risk quarantine and I may be tested 2 days back. I may be positive, but my team, I have said them that we will fight, and it is every day we are doing the communication on the this mobile platforms. So this is an opportunity in adversity. You can develop your health and you can force your government, you can advocate your government to develop your healthcare infrastructure. And the last point, which I asked, where is your point A? Where are you right now in the form of preparations? Do you have sufficient number of ventilators? Do you have sufficient number of oxygen points? Do you have sufficient number of isolation beds? Do you have that categorization of staff who will take care, like a normal doctor can take care of isolation ward, and the specialist can be reserved for these ventilators? So where is your point A? Right now, we are all at this point, I want to do it. And we are talking to each other about how do I do it. I think by this webinar and after this series, Dr. Balla, everybody should come to the point that I will do it. And after 4 to 6 weeks, we'll be happy to listen from you that yes, you have did it. So with this, I conclude and thank you very much. Namaskar, assalamu alaikum, and shukriya. And may God bless all, that we all get our boats passed out of this COVID-19 typhoon, and we will come out of it, I'm sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Varun. Actually, Dr. Sandeep just left. He's got some issue with his internet. He's joining back.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, may I request Dr. Tilak Silva, sir, that if you can just supplement wherever I think information is less, or some points, valuable points.
So you can unmute. Sir, you can unmute yourself.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
It was excellent presentation. Dr. Rai is fantastic. You covered every point. But just some the question that just lingering in my mind. In isolation of self-isolation in the home, can be a pulse oximeter. The pulse oximeters are very cheap, right? It's like a glucometer, you see. Can the person can afford, can he use it himself in the home isolation just to check whether sometimes the oxygen saturation can come down without, you know, any alarming, especially elderly or maybe a person. So can the pulse oximeter, cheap pulse oximeter like a glucometer, can be used in home isolation? What do you think?
I think, sir, you have nailed the right, I would say, opinion for all the home isolated COVID-19 positive patients. It is a very cheap intervention, and based on this intervention, a lot of people can be referred to the hospital center right now. So yes, pulse oximeter is a very, but surprisingly, many of the healthcare, I would say, authorities have not given that much emphasis on this pulse oximeter. All the isolated people should be advocated to do the pulse oximeter at least twice a day, check for their respiration rate or any other symptoms. In India, we are giving them a full pager for caretaker and a full page for the person that how he has to take care of himself. So this can be replicated at other places also. Sir, you will have to unmute, sir.
Please. Yes, thank you. Thank you. I think it was very informative. Point you gave, I think we can discuss among the Sri Lankan context as well. A person who could afford to, if in case. But only thing, Sri Lanka, you know, we don't encourage home isolation. Luckily, we have the facilities still, so we take them to the hospital setting and monitor. But even, you know, maybe months to come, perhaps maybe when the things come first, maybe we have to apply the same way the home isolation. So your point will be very useful. Thank you very much.
You are very right, sir. I think many of the countries in Africa and India, they have an opportunity that this is the time they can pool their resources and plan for the future. Today, home isolation may not be advocated depending on the number of cases, but yeah, Tomorrow we need to be prepared for it, that we can have this scenario. So what is the best approach in this scenario?
Yes, thank you. Excellent.
So some questions have been coming for you.
Yes, sir. There is a question. Yeah.
So I'll request other participants also. We are opening it the session for questions, and you can ask them. Itraconazole has shown antiviral properties in relation to coronavirus in cats and felines. It has also shown antiviral properties on cytomegalovirus. Sir, please provide us about stages of testing this on human lab clinical trials. So, Manik Kumar, I'll just like to answer that this is not the only drug. Many of the antifungals and antivirals are undergoing various clinical trials. I'm not very much sure that in actually country to country, there are various trials which are going on. The registry for the vaccines are there, that how many vaccines are under trial. But about pharmaceutical drugs, many of the, it is so many drugs at various trials that there is no complete access to various, I would say, pharmaceutical drugs. I'll just get the knowledge about this, that in which this trial phase it is. But many of the drugs have shown promise, but none of them has been advocated or proved by Government of India, except this hydroxychloroquine for prophylaxis. And by WHO, not a single drug has been advocated till now. Dr. Silva, would you like to say something about it? Itraconazole.
Yeah, please unmute, sir. Please unmute yourself.
Sir, unmute yourself.
I agree with you. If you think there's no controversy of it, I think a lot of drugs have been on the line in the trial, and I think we should stick on to the one that at least we have some evidence which has been positive onto that, other than trying, you know. I think there's nothing much I can add on to you.
So I think there are no other questions and answers. So, Dr. Bella, sir?
I don't think there are any other queries are there.
Yeah, no more questions as of now, sir.
We can answer them later also, if there are queries which will be developed later. So, yes, sir.
Vishnu, I don't think there are any queries.
No, sir. No questions as of now, sir.
Just a small question from my side. Well, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Yeah. Now, you see, now there's a big talk going on in the world. Okay. In this part of the region, are we have any kind of immunity? Well, say, when you take the stats, you know, I mean, talk about BCG vaccination, other thing we'll talk about. We have been exposed to so much of viral infection that we have added advantage, we have a head up start on against. Just to share, you know, just a food for thought, you know, do you have any experience on that in this part of the world? Are we have any advantage over this virulence of this virus attacking this part of the region, the world, for any reason, like could be a vaccination or maybe repeated infections of any other viral infections? Do you think anything, something sinister?
I think, sir, there has been many hypotheses which have been into the news. One was BCG vaccination, the other was latitude story, the third was malaria endemic areas, so use of chloroquine was advocated after that. So there has been many theories, even one of the genetic mutation theory, like the gene mutations are slowly are going to be in a coming to the stage where the virulence will be little bit declined. But all these theories with this number of cases, Indian scenario, are basically not having any stand. BCG trial has already been started by our government. The results will come, I think, in the next 6 months to 12 months. So only then we can be sure of, but these till now are just hypotheses. Like hydroxychloroquine has shown in vitro promise. But when talking about the trials, the case fatality is high. The only thing that is suggested is low dose chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine. But again, there has been a lot of hypothesis generating after day, but does not have a lot of stand. Repeated infection was one of them. From malaria and other, like our body is already having developed those antibodies. But looking at the number of cases in our country, I would say these hypotheses will not have a lot of stand in the coming days which are coming. Yeah. So one of the query has been asked by one of the panelists that how would you suggest PCR test all who come into contact or only them who develop some respiratory symptoms? So for others, I would say that there is a chat point in the down. If you want to ask any Q&A, you can ask some questions. So when the testing centers are overcrowded with the test for general population, patients undergoing surgeries and aerosol generating procedures. So sir, thank you for the questions. In the beginning, RT-PCR should be promoted for all the cases and all the high risk contacts. And I think like Sri Lanka would be doing it, and the countries like Myanmar is also doing it, the number of cases are less. But when we are talking about a place where already community transmission has been has already been set in that scenario, what we are doing, RT-PCR should be advised, but a suspected patient, high-risk contact, should be treated on guidelines of a COVID-19 positive test. Like, quoting example of India, there are few states where the test is coming positive after 3 to 4 days. And this is the same scenarios in some of the African countries when it takes time because the testing centers are not that much. In that scenario, we'll have to change our protocols. The first protocol is you test for all the person coming with ILI, influenza-like illness. You just do the isolation or the quarantine of all the high-risk contacts. And only if they develop ILI, you go for the RT-PCR. If you have less number of RT-PCR. Currently, the number of capacity of testing is high, but still, again, I would say, again, it depends on the region, on the country. Like the testing centers are overcrowded with the test for general population. So you have to prioritize. General population is now developing a fear factor that everybody who is having a cold and cough, he is having COVID-19 positive. Despite there is no COVID-19 positive contact history. So based on that scenario, I would say you just do the RT-PCR on the numbers available, how many contacts are coming and change it. There is one point which I would like to stress that there are some emergency cases which need urgent reports. So in Indian scenario, we have also advocated CBNAC, which gives result in 1 hour. RT-PCR takes around 6 hours minimum to get the results, and sometimes it takes 24 hours based on the problem statement. So some of the centers have also advocated for CBNAT, which has a good specificity. So those people can get the result in 1 to 2 hours, and the surgeries can be performed or aerosol generating procedures can be followed in that scenario. But yes, to protect your healthcare workers, it should be that all the people who are suspected coming from those areas which are having a high transmission of COVID-19 should be first tested for COVID-19 if time permits. So the other question was about what do you say about rapid test of COVID-19? Rapid test of COVID-19 now or today has not been advocated by government of various governments and also WHO. So rapid test is only for epidemiological study to understand that what is the problem statement, how many people are positive, asymptomatic also in your and have developed immunity. So the role of rapid test would come after 1 or 2 months when there will be so many cases which are asymptomatic or mild. So you can develop your strategy or refine your strategies based on that. So there are some question answers also. Thank you, anonymous, that nice presentation. Dr. Sunil, thank you. You have answered. RT-PCR questions I have already answered. Sir, I would like to also answer that these SOPs should be in place before the persons are coming. That any person who is coming for emergency surgeries, he should be referred for CBNAT. Any person who is suspected coming for an elective surgery, he should be basically advised for RT-PCR because still RT-PCR is the gold standard. So for emergency elective surgery based on their suspected, and if it is a COVID-19 positive patient, all you need is a good number of PPE kits and all the protocols in place to take care of these cases. Another question that has come is, sir, please comment on oral hygiene importance in the prevention of COVID-19. A valid question, sir. Oral hygiene is also advised that it is a part of, like your hand hygiene, cuff hygiene, is again the oral hygiene. The oral hygiene says that even if you are exposed and you are having some warm water, some Ayurvedic studies have said that drinking warm water, cleaning your mouth regularly, doing some pranayams, such kind of things have given some positive results. Oral hygiene stands for some use of antiseptic also, but again, it is the basically nasopharynx, through the nasal transmission it is going. So you have to take care of first your nose and then again your mouth. The warm water and regular hygiene, there has not been any studies on this. There has been some of the advisories only on the prevention of COVID-19.
Yeah, I think the nasal irrigation with the normal saline, which we should do for allergic rhinitis, seems to be quite helpful. Yeah. In cleaning the viral particles, you know, I think. What do you think about it? Is that will be helpful?
Sorry, sir. Sir, can you repeat, sir?
The nasal irrigation with normal saline.
Yeah.
Yeah. So twice daily at least will be helpful in long run, not only virus and otherwise.
We have another parallel system which is known as Indian system of medicine. So this is known as Jal Neti. And they like purification of your noses through warm saline water, so regular water on. So it is basically advocated in Ayurveda, but in allopathy, the only factor they are saying is that clear your mucosa through some others method. But yes, it has a lot of good promise in futures to come. We will have to explore our alternate medicines. Ayurveda, homeopathy, so and these kind of other parallel medicines can also help us, because right now we don't have any drugs in our allopathy which has shown clear cut evidences of treatment. So there is another article has been shown that which says by Dr. Malachi that goats and pawpaw tested positive in COVID-19 in Tanzania. So this is a worrisome situation, sir. It actually has been, till now, the evidence says it has been transmitted from animal to human beings. So now it is being said that it can also transmit from human to animal chain. So actually, I would say there has been sporadic incidences. Till now, no clear-cut evidences have been generated that it can transmit from human to animals. But still, it is having aerosol generations. So if there have been some people working in the poultry and other animal farms, so there can be scenarios. But again, I would say the first is human to human chain. That is very close. And the other is human to animal chain, which we need to take care. Yes, sir, it can transmit. Dr. Sunil has asked, yes, are boymen at higher risk of getting severe form of COVID-19? Yeah. So there has been two different evidences, I would say. One is on the blood group. So people are saying that people with blood group A, so they are at higher risk, and the people with blood group O are at less risk of developing severe disease or other COVID-19 symptoms. So this is in the same. I would rather quote it as one of the spurious association right now. The evidence is not there. This is kind of a temporal association that with time we can see that this is the background. But yes, if we are saying there is such scenarios, we can think about it. In bald men, there has been studies like some correlations with ACE inhibitors and others. But still, it does not stand ground. Again, I would repeat, sir, every day new evidences are coming. This is just adding to those theory of temporal zone, this temperature zone, like it will not spread into the warm areas. It will not spread into those areas which are malaria endemic. It will not spread into the BCA. So it will have less impact on the. So I think Dr. Silva is thinking that he's having less hair. So he's more prone. So I think Dr. Silva, you can also think about it. That yes, but these are incidental findings. I will not say that after a lot of clinical studies or these trials, this will hold their grounds.
There is one more which has come. Yeah. Belgium has seen human to cat transmission.
Yes, sir. I have also read about it. So, in Western countries, the human to cat, they are just keeping them as a family in their home. So, there are always chances. So, we will see such kind of scenarios sooner or later. So, we cannot keep a cat into mask. The only thing we can do is just prevent ourselves, use our mask to prevent our pets also in future.
I think we have come to the end then. Yeah, I think there are no more queries, and we have come to the end of this first session. Sorry, in between there were some issues, bandwidth issues from my side. I had to leave in between. But we are really thankful to all the respective colleagues, those who have joined today from different parts of the world, all healthcare professionals. We are really thankful to our eminent faculty, Dr. Varun Arora, for making this talk so elaborative and so clear. I think a lot of appreciations you have already received in the chat box itself. That is an excellent presentation. We are thankful to Dr. Tilak Silva from joining from Sri Lanka. Because I think, sir, leaders like you can play a big role in the health systems and in your respective countries. I think there is a exchange of learnings from all of you. I think this is the platform which PHFI, GDC, and RIS has created to exchange the innovative innovative things which are happening for the betterment of COVID-19 pandemic all across the globe. Tomorrow, again, we are going to have the second session and preparing healthcare facilities and protecting healthcare personnel, because protection of the healthcare personnel is utmost importance. And until unless they are not protected, how they can protect the patients and their families afterwards. So tomorrow, again, at the same o'clock, we are looking forward to have all of you here. And,
I would like to give my good well wishes to you, Dr. Arora. I hope you be safe and fine, and my prayers are with you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Silva, for joining from Sri Lanka, and thank you for all the valuable inputs which you have shared during the talk also. With this, we have come to the end of the session. All the best. Take care. Stay safe. Stay home wherever you are, or do the safe work during this pandemic moment also. All the best. Take care.